Okay, welcome. I know a lot of you have come here to hear something about Planet X, and this video will focus like a magnet upon this whole issue of Planet X, Nibiru. But also, if you're new to this channel, I always put it into a spiritual context because really our spiritual path is our first priority. This is how my life has been. I was born with a knowledge of the coming catastrophes of space rocks. As a child in the late 50s, early 60s, I tried to tell people and I tried to act it out for them by throwing rocks. I was trying to say, look, this is going to happen. And certainly when Velikovsky's works came to my attention, I was immersed in those, and Sitchin's works. I was very, very immersed in all of those, ancient history. So I've been steeped my whole life in this issue of a coming Earth catastrophe, and I'm very, very, very well read and knowledgeable about it. However, this has never been my first priority. The first priority is spiritual awakening, because ultimately we have to realize that this is all a dream. It's a cosmic dream, and has nothing to do with what we are actually. We're invulnerable. We can never be at any disadvantage whatsoever. We're formless spirit. So let's keep this in mind. And something that I find when I go to other videos on Planet X, occasionally I look at them and I'm always sort of disappointed because they don't seem to bring the spiritual into it. And I find that the spiritual is intimately connected with this whole coming catastrophe, which I put at 100%, by the way. In terms of space rocks coming in, I'm putting it at 100%. It is absolutely going to happen. Space rocks are going to hit what I think is the oceans. And I don't know how many, at least two, I would say, but this is just a beginning. So that's a big issue, what is coming up. The elites know there's a big issue coming up. That's why they're building the bunkers. As far as lacking a spiritual context, this is an epidemic among all the videos. I say, what's going on? You're missing the boat. Because this is when the rapture is going to occur. This is what Jesus promised. Jesus knew all about this coming catastrophe and the end of this age. And he said that's when he would return towards the end of this age, and that he has prepared a place for us, and he will take those who want to go there. He will take them there. There's a way to get there. Now, I've also said that I'm aware that Jesus has already returned to this world, and he returned. It's almost a year now since he's returned to this planet with his full attention here. And he's been laying low. He made an announcement to the world: "I'm back. I come here as your friend, to relate with you all as a friend." So we're coming up on that 1 year anniversary towards the end of April, beginning of May. So it's very important that we realize, yes, there's trouble coming, but yes, there's spiritual help coming, and the spiritual help is greater than the trouble. And this has to be emphasized. Now, what I want to say, several things I'm going to talk about here in this video, we're going to look at together, is the Holy Spirit has been telling me, look back in history. Okay, go back in history. The supposed cycle of these troubles throughout history is 3,600 years. So if you go back from this date of 2016, 3,600 years, you get BC 1644. Okay, look, let's go back BC 1644. Well, what do we find? Well, what we find is if you go back from that, you get back to near 5,000 something, and then 8,000. It goes back. If you really trace it back scientifically, there's been some articles written on this. There is this record, historical record, for catastrophes every 3,600 years. There most certainly is. And in 1644 BC, there's a very strong indication of a tremendous catastrophe. Then you go back to 5,000, there isn't, then back to 8,000, 8,000 something, and that's the time of Noah, supposedly, where there was this huge flood, where the oceans may have been come out of their basins to some extent, may have been some sort of pole shift. The Egyptians have records of the sun reversing directions in the sky in terms of rising in the west and setting in the east twice during their long history. So if you go back in history, the scientific records of trace, the way they do trace things in ice cores and all of this, the record of this 3,600 year perturbation, of the disturbance of this world is there. It's very much there. And based on the 1644, where the last spike began, we're now at that 3,600 year cycle, right this year. So this is why there's this big uptick in videos and attention on this. And the elites, as much as people don't like them, they're not stupid. They have access to instrumentation, observatories, satellites, a lot of private stuff. They get information the public doesn't get. They most certainly do. The governmental, high governmental agencies, the spy agencies, there's all sorts of interlocking agencies of this elite global structure. They have way, way better information than the public is aware of. And so they have been going pell-mell to build underground cities, actually. There's one source that I find is pretty darn credible. Weighing everything I say, this guy is quite credible. And he says that he has high-level contacts in government and the elite with the elites. And he says that there are many, many the biggest city in the United States underground is about 10,000 people. In Russia, they have 150,000. China is also building massive amounts of underground installations. This is going on worldwide. Why? Obviously they know something is up. Now, the Planet X thing is very confusing because there's three players involved here. We can simplify here. This is my job. I'm a generalist. I'm good at simplifying because it is simple. Truth is very simple, actually. We're trying to buy our way out of reality, and that becomes extremely complex. In fact, it's impossible. We can't do it, but we don't think it's impossible. We just think it's massively complex. So our mind's really focused on complexity. But truth is very simple, and it's very difficult for us to see just how simple and true it is, just as it is, without adding complexity. And this is the trouble with what we call awakening enlightenment, is our minds are so addicted to complexity that we have great trouble in seeing simplicity. We truly do. It is the most difficult thing there is here in this world to see the simple truth. And this is what I have focused on in my life, and have done some good work in this direction, to be sure. I seem to be allied with the great Dharma King Longchenpa as one of his subordinates. He's somehow spiritually responsible for my awakening at this point, it would seem. And so, all homage to the great Dharma King, and the grace of the Guru is sufficient to awaken us. Keep this in mind. Do not underestimate the grace of these Dharma Kings and Queens. They are capable, their grace is capable of awakening us to the sheer simplicity of truth. And in fact, Longchenpa, when I first met him, did awaken me briefly to the vision, the awareness of intrinsic spaciousness. And so he showed me I can do this. And so I do have faith in the power of these great gurus, these great spiritual presences, these great saviors. Call them what you want. I do have faith they are capable of awakening us to the sheer simplicity of truth if we really want to and have prepared properly. So I advise everybody to continue their faith in whatever their savior may be, if it's Jesus, if it's Ramana Maharshi, if it's someone else, it's this and that. Keep your faith and add to your faith right now, because there is trouble coming. The elites are not going to all this trouble just for their own amusement. I can promise you that. And there's a secondary level of elites, which are like the very wealthy, but they're not quite as high up. And they are building their own underground bunkers, actually. I'm personally aware of this. I've actually been in one. But these are small potatoes. The real power structure has built cities underground. Okay, they have these nuclear-powered boring machines that produce so much heat they just melt the rock, and they go through very quickly. They can put like 40 foot wide tunnels. It is amazing what they can do, and it's like glass, smooth like glass, and no residue. They just go right through. They have these machines and have been using them for quite some time, just like we've had nuclear submarines for quite some time. So they know there's trouble coming. The elites know of this periodicity. Now, what I have to add to this mix? Well, first of all, there's three issues. I said I would simplify it for you. There's three issues. One is the brown dwarf, our twin star. We live in a binary star system, which this is coming to light. But this brown dwarf is at supposedly never gets too close to us. The closest it gets might be Pluto, as it has a sort of a, they say, 26 million year cycle. It comes in close to Pluto. But keep in mind, when it comes to Pluto, it's gone through the Kuiper Belt and the Oort Belt, pushing massive amounts of comets into towards the solar system. Rocks, massive amount. So some are saying that they're seeing this brown dwarf, you know, relatively close to our solar system, which would mean that it's already pushed a lot of space rock in towards us, okay? It may be that it's in this 26 million year cycle. Now, Jesus in the Bible said that this coming catastrophe will be the worst the world's ever experienced, and if those days weren't cut short, nothing living would survive on the face of the earth. Well, he didn't say about underground, did he? So, this seems to indicate that this brown dwarf star may be at its closest point to our solar system right now. It means it's already gone through the Kuiper Belt and the Oort Belt, where you have all these belts of space rock, massive amounts, which means it's already pushed a massive amount in towards us, which is why we should expect we're going to get hit. And people have talked about a great many, you know, more, you know, rocks, meteorites, stuff coming in is increasing. Very likely. Also, when our twin star gets closest to us, it produces an effect upon our weather. In fact, it affects the weather systems of all planets of our solar system. And if you look over the last, you know, 15, 20 years, or however you want to go back, there's no question that this has happened. In fact, it's not just the Earth. We see global warming here. All planets on our solar system have had drastic climate changes on them. There's drastic changes happening to every single planet in our solar system. This is very likely caused by our twin brown dwarf star nearing our solar system, getting as close as it gets. So there's some that say that this brown dwarf is going to come through our solar system. I don't believe that celestial mechanics allow for that. I don't believe that's going to happen at all. But this is one theory. The second theory, okay, is that this brown dwarf has planets orbiting it, like our sun has planets orbiting it, okay? And that one of these, but the theory is that there's actually a planet that is orbiting both the sun and the brown dwarf, which they call Nibiru, Planet X. This is a theory, and these theorists say that this planet X is going to actually come into our solar system on a 3,600 year orbit, okay? And the final theory is that it's these space rocks are on this 3,600 year cycle that they get pushed into our system and they go on this cycle. So we have that as well. This doesn't quite account for the timing of if this brown dwarf has come in this time through the Oort cloud. There would be, you know, additional disturbances, which could make, that doesn't mean that the 3,600 year cloud of space debris rocks isn't still also operative. Maybe that will be operative with additional space rocks, which makes the event even worse. So the first one is, again, the brown dwarf coming through our solar system. Don't think that's going to happen, but it does have, it is influencing our, you know, magnetic influence upon the Earth, weather influence, all these subtle space influences, it influences this, and it seems to be doing that. The other is then that this Planet X Nibiru, 3,600 year orbit around both brown dwarf and the sun, and this is a planet with itself has like four or five moons, and this will go around the sun and then come out around the sun and produce a tremendous magnetic effect on us with a lot of space rocks coming in. And the third is that there's this group of comets or space rocks together that they will come in and probably go around the sun and then go past us, and maybe many rocks will hit us, something like that. So those are the basic three, and I'd say the last two are the ones that are much more likely to happen. And so we don't, right at this point, I am not sure which it is. But at some point, this will emerge. But at the very least, I would say that we are going to be hit by space rocks, and we're going to be hit suddenly without warning. Just as Jesus said, the catastrophe will come like a thief in the night, we won't even see it coming. And NASA says, "Oh, there's no worry. There's nothing's going to hit us." And we ask them, "Well, what percentage of the space rocks do you think you've mapped already and identified?" And they say, "Well, maybe about 10%." Okay, well, what about the other 90? "Well, yeah, we haven't found them yet." "Well, but you could say categorically, scientifically, that we're not in any danger." I mean, what kind of science is that? You should say you have a 10% certainty about your statement. And they're not accounting for the new ones that could be coming in if this brown dwarf has indeed gone through the Kuiper Belt and the Oort cloud. So, their job is to keep the public from panicking. You can understand that, but take what this NASA says worth a grain of salt, at the most. There are many, many intuitives, and I'm one of those who's been on this issue for a long time. And we have way better information than NASA could ever have. And so they're going about in a very, very narrow, blindfolded way. And even they probably know what's going on, and they're not allowed to tell the public anyway, so they have to make up these stories. So now, what I would like to add to this whole discussion is something that came up today. Several things. In the previous video, I talked about the Planet X and the Christian connection. And it's very, very interesting about how the Eucharist and the sacrifice of Jesus and all of this is designed to try to prevent the return of this great, cosmic destroyer. Whatever, whether it's a group of comets or big space rocks grouped together, or is it actually planet Nibiru coming through the solar system. Whatever it is, it seriously seems to have a periodicity to it that is in the ice cores record. And it also has the record of ancient history, which is very powerful and very profound. And I've studied that to a great extent. And being a generalist, what I'm going for is the essence of it. I'm not an academic. And so I don't go on side trips. I say, okay, that's not, let me get to the root of it. Let's get to the core of this. What is most vitally important here? We want you to know. And the fact is that the ancients certainly wrote about this and passed this down orally, passed it down in records in many different ways. There's no question that they believe there was this nemesis that caused great catastrophe on this earth. And if you go back, you realize that there were these catastrophes. So it's extremely likely that there is some sort of troublemaker in our that comes through the solar system periodically. Really, I would say, you could say it's virtually 100%. That is virtually 100%. And whether that causes us to get hit by space rocks or not, I would say it's 100% that we are going to get hit at some point, significantly hit by space rocks. So we have the Christian connection. And I talked about the Eucharist is a type of sympathetic magic sort of thing that our psyche has, of believing we can get rid of something that threatens us by gradually by fragmenting it into little pieces symbolically, and then consuming those pieces, killing the pieces, as it were. And in this case, we eat the Eucharist, and so many, many Christians have been eating this Eucharist for thousands of years. I believe it's a sympathetic magic way, a magical way of trying to get rid of this incoming nemesis that has tormented this planet for so long. In the sacrifice of Jesus to appease the wrath of God, they believe that the wrath of God sends this planet in to punish us for our sins, or this whatever it is, this we'll call it a planet for now, but a planet / comet cluster. And so by giving God what was most precious to us, which is the Jesus, we're showing just how, it's like a payment, saying, "God, you want Jesus too, and we have him, but we're going to give him back to you, and this will make you so pleased with us, you will stop sending this terrible nemesis into this planet to torment us." So it's like an appeasement religion, an attempt to get rid of this nemesis, and so we can have peace on earth. The millennial, the idea of Christian is that there's going to be this millennium where Jesus will reign over this beautiful, peaceful time on earth, and there's no more trouble. Although they do say that after, 1,000 years or whatever, it means a long time, that there may be some further trouble. So they may be just saying after this great tribulation, there'll be another 3,600 years where we don't get, clobbered. It may maybe what they're trying to get at. So we brought that to light. But there's something also very fascinating about the elites and about ancient history. If you're really an ancient history buff and you're a generalist like I am, and you go through a lot of information because you're not getting hung up on trivia, And what you do is you distill the essence of it all. And what I've gotten from ancient history is there seems to be epochs of civilization on this planet where they rise and they fall, and they rise and the fall. And the fall seems to be very precipitous. And that after this fall, it seems as like we almost start all over again. It's very strange. Okay. And also, though, what's also odd is it seems like humanity after this fall seems to be in like this almost like a dumb state of mind. Like they don't know how to function anymore. It's really weird. And yet there's always this priestly class, demigod, godlike divine beings, whatever you want to call it, that always seems to come upon the scene and reintroduce civilization to the planet. And this is something that's been bothering me about ancient history. I just couldn't figure it out. I said, I can't come up with any theory that can explain history, really. But if you plug in the periodicity of Planet X slash comet cluster, every 3,600 years, and sometimes being worse than others, and you posit some very severe catastrophes, even including what I say is a profound magnetic effect on the world that might erase people's memories on the surface, could produce massive trauma, and this could certainly cause a fall of civilization back into almost like a Stone Age culture, where the people just seem to just be dazed and confused and have lost all touch with civilization. Now, here's the key. Here's the key element to this. If we see right now that the elites, the way they're dealing with this is to go underground, and they feel very confident this will protect them from this. And if the ancients had knowledge of the periodicity of this, and they'd seem to study the skies intently as if they were definitely looking for something, signs of some return of some catastrophe, so that I believe they were absolutely aware of this, they too would be very much wise enough, because some of these ancient civilizations are actually quite sophisticated, like the Egyptian. They had all sorts of energy technology, the Egyptians. And you can go way back, and it's pretty amazing what you can find. They would absolutely know that by going underground, they could protect themselves from this. Now, I read a book quite some time ago by this amazing author who'd authored many books. I can't quite remember his name. But one of his books had to do with his knowledge of all the underground tunnels in the world, in ancient cities and tunnels, and what was under the ground. And part of what he did was he specialized in Tibet, and he talked about that. But he also said they're interconnected with all the continents. There's a massive tunneling system under the world. And he gave amazing evidence of this and knowledge of this. It was quite extraordinary. And so, along with a lot of other anecdotes and evidence from history, there seems to be very strong indication that the ancients had extensive underground capability. Extensive. They had capability of somehow liquefying the tunnels. There's people who talk about the Mayan and Incan areas of discovering tunnels that were just glass-like walls, and so somebody knew how to tunnel underneath the world. They had the technology to do it. Some have talked about coming across large underground ancient installations. Somebody built all these sophisticated pyramids. I mean, the ancient peoples had sophistications of interesting types, actually. So it is very likely that in ancient times, when the return of this great, troublemaker was coming back, and they were able to somehow notice from astrological careful observations that it was starting to come back. Prior to that, they would probably make provisions to go underground. And so when this catastrophe would come upon the world, they would most certainly be deep underground, very, very safe and protected from it. So now the catastrophe would happen on the surface of the earth. The people would just be driven back into the Stone Age, and tremendous mental trauma, if not magnetic effects on their memory and mind, which turn them into kind of, primitives again. And as they're wandering around trying to survive, guess what? Out of the ground come all these elites who still have all their knowledge and mind completely intact, who are very sophisticated, very keen, who may have brought a lot of stuff with them underground. They come out with animals, they come out with seeds, they come out with, and they reintroduce agriculture to the world. And they form this priestly king class. elite class of the people may say, "Oh, you're gods, you know. You know." Then the gods appeared and gave us agriculture and civilization and writing and all this stuff. But see, the elites never lost it. They were underground. So this may have happened over and over and over again, and it's about history is about to repeat itself, because the elites are bringing so much stuff underground for protection, and when the surface goes through its great tribulation later on. Now, I was actually shown a movie in about the year, was it 1999, I think, something like that, when I was asleep, and it was clearly, this movie said, was showing me the future of this world, this planet. And I did see this great tribulation taking place. And after it had stopped and everything had calmed down, I saw all these people coming up from underground. They had been living underground this whole time. I also saw people arriving in spaceships also. And there's the combination of these two groups, reintroduced civilization to this planet. And they had all these seeds. I saw the whole thing take place like a movie. So I would say this accounts, if you plug this theory in to history, this really answers so many questions. Then stuff goes clicks, and you go, oh my gosh, this really fits. Because all these tales of the divine beings coming and giving us, you know, civilization, these were, by and large, the elites who had been pre-warned, knew this coming disaster, and went underground, and they had these underground living facilities. They know how to tap the energy of the earth, the heat of the earth, the various energies of the earth, for all the energy they need to grow stuff hydroponically, to grow stuff. They have techniques. Back then, they had very, very amazing techniques. They might have stored a massive amount of grain and food down there to last for years and years and years. And then when the surface, you know, things calm down, they reemerge. They reemerge. And people say, they have no idea where they came from. They think they're God. God just appeared to us. They say, well, God, the gods just appeared to us and gave us civilization. These are the elites coming up from underground. So just plug that into history. Plug this Planet X comet cluster, you know, periodic, 3,600 periodic troublemaker into history, and then the elites being aware of it and going underground and surviving it and coming back, and then the surface people being just decimated and then reintroducing civilization. Plug that into history and see how that feels to you. To me, it answers a lot of questions, a lot of questions. The Egyptians were certainly aware of these cosmic disturbances, and the Sumerians were as well. Sumerian civilization seemed to just appear out of nowhere. You know, it was quite amazing. Now, some people say, you know, the ETs did it all. Well, they may have done some of it, but I believe it wasn't only the ETs. It was certainly the elites going underground here. Okay, it absolutely, I feel this is what happened. And the extensive ancient underground systems that people have discovered, who are really in the know about this, indicates, you know, that this option was certainly available. So very likely this is available. And people say there are more discoveries in Egypt of these huge underground areas with super sophisticated technology, right, that are still there. And so you just start thinking about what's happening right now. As we know, I mean, there's nobody really denying that the elites are going underground, all right? I mean, it's they are. They have done so. And people say, well, there's $1 trillion missing here, $1 trillion. I mean, where's the money going? Well, it's going into these massive underground installations, not just in the U.S., all over the world, especially the wealthy countries. They're doing it for a reason. They expect trouble on the surface, and they expect to ride out the trouble underground and then reemerge later on, where they will maintain their elite status. They'll be even more elite than ever, right? And these elites keep this knowledge within their echelon, as it were, and pass this information down. And so this is why people have started to get, you know, dug into this, realize, you know, these secret societies that, you know, pass on this information. Some people, like the Masons, know about this, you know, troublemaker, and various secret societies. That is because they're part of the elite structure that has survived these cataclysms throughout history. And they come and they bring, you know, philosophy and religion and music and all of civilization, as if, you know, it's like ready-made. It was just there, being given to these primitive people, but they really weren't before. They weren't so primitive. There's evidence of great civilizations before. What happened to them? You see, there's no real explanation that fits unless there has been some surface catastrophes periodically. But then, how did we get back so quickly? Well, because the elites came out from underground and just reintroduced all this stuff to us. They had the capability for textiles, all this knowledge, and then they had beautiful jewelry and textiles, and then they had people just like, oh my gosh, we don't even know how to do this, because they lost their mind was kind of so severely traumatized in various ways, and then gradually they sort of tried to remember, oh, maybe I have this ability, and they gradually pull the civilization builds itself back up again. This, I think, is a better theory for history than anything that I've come across. The stuff that I've come across just merely simply doesn't have answers, really. And so they fudge a lot. They fudge a lot. They really. But I used to drive me to distraction in school because I said, everything you're teaching here is a lie. I knew it was a lie when I was a schoolboy in history and science, all stuff. I said, this is nonsense. I was got so upset with my teachers in school. I basically quit listening when in 7th grade. I said, this is nothing but lies that you're teaching. You are teaching such a false picture of history. It's ridiculous. But somehow I knew what history was really about. I was just born with this knowledge. And it's catastrophic. Catastrophic theory is what I believe is true theory. Okay, it is true theory, and this is what's really happened in this world. Now, but one element that people are overlooking is Jesus' promise that this time he's going to come back and he's going to take us off of this planet so we don't have to go through this terrible cycle again. But I believe it's very important that we understand the periodicity of these catastrophes and how history has played out the way it has. And I believe by seeing this, the Holy Spirit's been telling me, you've got to get this out to people. It's very important. So I'm doing it now. There's something about seeing this, you just say, oh, wow, okay, I really get it. Now I understand what's taking place in this planet. And I don't want to stay here. This is ridiculous. I don't want this rise and fall, rise and fall, rise and fall. We're done with this. We're done with it. We're done with this. And this is very liberating. I believe very, very liberating. So we'll say, sure, let's go somewhere else. Well, it doesn't have this issue. History, I mean, the history of this planet is a drag. It really is a drag. It's kind of like it to me. I look back and it feels like these people used to be something great, and they lost it, and they're now trying to like fake it. There's some kind of mental struggle going on with them. It is really odd, but this certainly explains it, doesn't it? These ancients that you could see that it's almost like they used to be great, but not anymore. And there's some mental block that they can't get around. And some people posit, well, there's some dark Lucifer force came down and changed their genetics and blah blah blah. No, I think catastrophe hit the planet and traumatized them so severely, and there may have been some magnetic effects, some severe EMP pulses, magnetic pulses, that like erasing a hard disk. You put EMP strong enough EMP pulses, all the electronics are, their memories are wiped out, electronically. Well, our mind is kind of like a computer, our brain at least. So, don't you think that this biocomputer could also have its memory wiped out? Absolutely, it could, like electroconvulsive therapy, ECT, that often erases short-term memory for a while. If you have enough of it, it may erase all your memories. If you put enough electricity through the brain, it tends to wipe out the memory. And you don't know who you are, where you've been, you don't know your history, you don't know anything. And you're like a simpleton again. And then these elites come out of the ground and say, oh, look at all these, you're a simpleton. Okay, we know how to do this, you don't. And they say, oh, wow, you're all the almighty. Where do you come from? They say, well, we're kind of divine. We're like gods. We're here to help you. And oh, okay. And then, so they spring up these religions, these aristocracies, and all this stuff. And then, of course, the people are very traumatized and unruly. And then the wars happen. And you get this terrible history that we've had here in this planet. The history is really just awful. The fall of civilizations is just awful. If you go back, keep going back and really dig into it, just say, what in the world? This is bizarre. And real hardcore scientists, pun intended, who dig into the cores, do the hard work of digging into cores, they'll tell you. They'll say, "May I tell you, we are finding stuff here that doesn't jibe with conventional history." What they tell you, we find there are spikes, severe spikes in massive rapid change on this planet of all different types that could very well be termed as catastrophic on the surface. And Velikovsky did a lot of good work. I feel I don't subscribe to his theories about Venus and various things. He did not have Planet X, the periodicity of that. He didn't really tap into that thing. Sitchin tapped into it a lot better, a lot better. And there are others. There's a lot of work being done now that has really helped, clarify the bigger picture, and I'm helping out with that about the elites going underground, the periodicity of this reintroducing civilization over and over again, the Christian Church actually being this sort of appeasement effort to try and, through magic, to get rid of Planet X comet cluster. The Eucharist, I believe, is the way they try to do this, as well as long as and the sacrifice of Jesus, trying to appease God in this way. So here, God, you can have Jesus back, and in return for us giving you Jesus back, you stop sending this, nemesis into our solar system and producing catastrophe. And then along with Jesus insisting there's going to be this terrible calamity at the end of the age, and that he is coming back at the end of the age, and I say he's already back. And I had a dream. Clearly, I saw Jesus addressing the world spiritually, at the spiritual level, not the physical. So he addressed us spiritually and said, "I am back." These words are very clear. "I am back. I am here to relate with all of you as a friend." And that's all he said. That's all he said. But that was about a year ago. So for me, he is clearly back. I know a lot of Christians expect Jesus back anytime. I say he's already back. And I feel 100% sure about this, which means this is the end of the age. Okay, and the amazing thing is that the spike of 1644 BC, this huge spike showing very likely some drastic quick change came upon the world and continued for quite some time till 1622, or about 20 years or so. Disturbance, very bad disturbance. If you take the periodicity of 3,600 years and add it to that 1644 BC, you get 2016, right now, this year. Now, what the Holy Spirit has been showing me through this amazing synchronicity of events that have the stamp of the Holy Spirit upon me. If you really have paid attention to the Holy Spirit, there's a signature it has. The way it orchestrates stuff that are real attention getters, and you say, "Ah, I think this is an attention getter," and then there'll be another and another and another like this. And the way it all happens, you realize this is definitely the Holy Spirit getting my attention, saying, "I want you to put your attention on this. This is very important." Not only has the Holy Spirit continuously put my attention on rocks coming in and hitting the earth, it has also give my attention to the urgency of this that is going to happen very soon. So if you plug that in with what I say is the fact that Jesus has already returned to this planet, and as he said he would do at the end of the age, timing right at this catastrophe, time of the catastrophe, you have many, many people saying, and myself included, that 2016 is a very important year. The Holy Spirit it told me over a year ago, I would say, maybe it's a year and a half, it's been quite some time, that July of this year, and it pinpointed July 24th recently, July 24th of this year, very important date. Something's going to be trouble. There's something is going to big is going to happen. The end of May, early June, and then late July. There's great urgency about this time, the end of July of this year. So I don't know exactly what's going to happen then, but many, many people expect there's going to be tremendous trouble in 2016, even cosmic trouble. Cosmic trouble. It is possible. It is very possible. And it is possible that the rapture will happen in 2016. There are also many, many saying that and having calculated this and coming out of 2016, is the year. And it's very interesting, the 1644 BC date, because I've had dreams of like a figure of Jesus wearing number 44. and talking with him. And I've been pointing to the Holy Spirit, says, look at 44. And if you go back in history, that was the last time this comet, 1644, was the last time this troublemaker came through this area, caused a great deal of trouble. We also have the 44th president right now in the United States. This 44 is very interesting. It keeps coming up. And the Holy Spirit says, go back in history and look at this. Very important. Wow, it's kind of shocking to see 1644 would be exactly the date from 216. So you're getting a lot of information, and trying to go through it on YouTube is like a nightmare, because there are a lot of amateurs that are just, you know, flinging anything against the wall, and they're not really steeped in it. You know, they're newcomers. I've been steeped in it my entire life. I've absolutely believed in this. This is going to happen. I've tried to alert people my whole life, and nobody would listen. Really, this is a fact. It's so frustrating that people didn't understand. But now people are waking up to it big time. Okay, they really are, which is great. I just thank everyone who's had a role in this. You know, they're just great work. Sitchin really helped out a lot. So did Velikovsky, showing that the universe is not this Christian notion of some stable, perfect, you know, watch-like thing that is just all, you know, works perfectly and immaculately, and there's no trouble and all this stuff. He said, oh, no. You know, it's somewhat chaotic and troublesome. And all the scientists who've dug into the situation and actually done the testings and readings, going back archaeologically, geologically, and come up with a lot of evidence, you know, all thanks to them too. So it's been a collective effort, the scientists, the intuitives, you know, and all sorts of different people who have brought this to our attention. And you better bet that the people who are paying most attention are the elites. They must have some very powerful information. I think they've been aware of this for quite some time, since maybe the early 80s, that I believe some evidence came out that they may have spotted something that indicated, you know, and they have records. The Vatican, I'm sure the Vatican has records. Some of these secret societies, elitist societies, have records going back. I'm sure they have discovered archaeological records, writings that they don't share with the public, a whole bunch of threads they have, which I believe they're very much aware of this situation and have been for quite some time. If they discovered something like that in as a scroll in Egypt or whatever, do you really think they're going to publish that? No, they're not, because that might cause, you know, panic in society and might interrupt their plans to hide away and all sorts of reasons. And so they may keep it for themselves. So I am sure that they have information that very clearly points out, you know, there's trouble, very imminent trouble. But, you know, what they have may be the booby prize. It's the ones who have prepared, as Jesus indicated we should prepare, who are able to go along with this shift, you know, a shift into another dimension, into another dwelling place, however you want to put it, to essentially sidestep the trouble that's coming. It's pretty doggone interesting. I was on the freeway today. It was very interesting. This is what happened to me on the freeway today. You talk about constellation of events. I'm going to give you an example. I'm driving on this freeway here in California, Bay Area 280. I'm up by Page Mill Road, going north on 280. It's a big four-lane freeway, and there's another lane to exit. Well, maybe one of the lanes exits at Page Mill, the fourth lane. And so there's this car in the fast lane, and I'm behind them in the second to left lane. And suddenly this car just takes almost like a right turn, just veers across all four lanes of traffic. And fortunately, the traffic wasn't heavy. I mean, they took such a severe turn, I thought the car was going to flip. I mean, they're going 75 miles an hour or so. To take an abrupt turn like that, it was scary as heck. They did slow down a little bit. And they barely made the exit on Page Mill, and they hit the concrete curb there and the dirt island, you know, they have the boom. I mean, it was insane what they did. Just insane. So I was like, whoa, something just suddenly veers right across. Like they went across those four lanes of freeway almost perpendicular to traffic, virtually perpendicular. That's the most radical thing I've ever seen. So I said, wow, I was shaken up by that. I said, that's a lunacy. That's crazy. So something very abruptly, you know, veers across us. I said, wow. Now, about a minute later, there's this pickup truck I'm coming across in the fast lane. I'm still in the second to fastest lane. And it's bed of the pickup truck is just pile high, you know, all the way up like 8 feet or so with stuff. All this stuff is what looks like the Beverly Hillbillies. And I say, and it's got this rug over it covering some, and it's flapping in the wind and everything. I said, wow, that doesn't look very well tied down and everything. And just as I recognized and saw this, suddenly stuff starts disgorging itself from the back of the truck. This large wastebasket full of stuff suddenly flies right toward me. Then there's this large plastic bin. Boom! The stuff is flying out the back of the truck, right at me. And it went right in front of my vehicle, and I hit it. You know, it ran over. I hit this plastic bin with a right tire, and sent it, you know, careening across the freeway. Fortunately, I have a heavy vehicle. So I say, well, bring it on. You know, I could handle this, but I was scared. I mean, this stuff was just flying out of the truck right at me. And so I was kind of upset about this. I mean, but later on, usually, I mean, there's a superficial reaction, but then right away I said, yeah, but what is the Holy Spirit trying to tell me here? Let me not be paranoid here. Let me not say, you know, oh, what was me, these idiots, blah, blah, blah. I say, hey, maybe the Holy Spirit, this is the grace of God. I'm fine. Maybe this is the grace of God trying to tell me something. That maybe something's going to veer across the path of this planet, like that car, and maybe the stuff is going to, like, out of, from its tail or whatever, is going to come in and hit the planet. Like the stuff flying out of the back of that truck. Because my attention is very much on this Planet X situation. So I said, yeah, maybe this is the Holy Spirit getting my attention again. But it showed me that your vehicle, you know, is so strong and heavy and big and tough that, you know, it's not going to affect you. That might have been part of it, or maybe not. Maybe it was just saying, no, this stuff is definitely coming in, and it's going to hit you hard, this world. The elites think that something's going to hit hard. I mean, they wouldn't do all this trouble just, I mean, unless they, you know, if they expected a nuclear holocaust, maybe, but I don't think they dig so deep, you know, if it was a nuclear holocaust type of thing. They're definitely protecting themselves from EMP pulses, I believe. Digging deep into granite mountains and things like that, where they place themselves. So it seems as though they want to protect themselves from a global catastrophe. I don't believe it's nuclear war. Now, there's another dream I had maybe a decade ago or so, where I was shown what is to come again in very symbolic terms. And there was this big mountain of rock, and suddenly from this mountain of rock, like a bank on the edge of this rock, big mountain of rock, broke away and came flooding into where I was, which I consider like the world. It came in and rolled out across the world and a certain area. And I said, wow, that's terrible. And it seemed like it shocked the world, and people struggled. And I thought, oh, maybe this is the end of our civilization. This is the dream I was having. And then I saw that civilization reconstituted itself. I said, oh, that's amazing. We made it through. And then in this dream, I saw another collapse of rocks from this big rock mountain. And they again came tumbling into this world and again crushed civilization. That it was a city that was being, in the dream it showed this. But again, we bounced back from it. And I said, wow, that is just amazing how we're able to bounce back. What a great job. How fortunate we are. I thought, okay, we're safe now. And then, next in the dream, I've shown a massive collapse on the side of the mountain of rock coming into the world. It was way, way bigger than the previous two. I don't even know, a scale of like 1,000 times. I mean, it was just bigger than that. It was just way bigger. And this just inundated us with rock. And I was fleeing this. I was fleeing it. It was horrible. And I went to another realm, another place. And I said, hey, can we take refuge here? Because I said, do you know what happened in our place? And they said, yeah, we know all about it. We were completely aware of what happened. And so we prepared a place for you that you can stay. And I said, you mean, can I take refuge here? They say, absolutely. We're all prepared for you. And I said, oh, thank God. This is amazing. And I went about the place and I said, oh my gosh. They said, this is way more beautiful than our world, our place that I came from. It's way better. I get to stay here. They said, our house is your house. And you stay as long as you want. We'd love to have you here. And just total hospitality. And so I felt I could just stay there as long as I wanted. And I was safe. But then I went back and looked at the place that I had left, the world that I had left. And the people were just buried in the dust in this rock. And they were just stunned. They were just like, they couldn't move. They were just, their minds were just fried. They were so stunned. They couldn't function. I was like, oh my gosh, this is horrible. So it seems, and I haven't been able to figure out this dream until I plug in this Planet X comet cloud situation, this periodicity of catastrophe, cosmic catastrophe. When you plug that in, the dream really fits, because what the dream is showing is that there's been two previous major catastrophes in civilization, you might say. You might maybe Noah's flood, okay, that really decimated civilization very badly, but civilization sprang back up and started thriving once again. But this third breakaway of rock, which I think this mountain symbolizes the Kuiper Belt and the Oort cloud, this huge gathering of rock, okay, and the rocks get pushed away, break away from that, and come into this world. But this one is way, way worse than the previous others, and this correlates with Jesus saying this final catastrophe of this age will be the worst ever, and nothing will survive if those days aren't cut short. So I believe that indicates these incoming rock will be the worst ever. Now, but there were survivors. There were survivors. This is what I saw. So, does history repeat itself again? And those who, it's interesting that they have the elites underground, but what I saw, that I was taken to another place. I was able to go to another place, another world, another realm. And I was able to come back from that realm. So it may be a combination of the elites coming from underground, and then those coming back, those who fled, coming back to this world to help reconstitute civilization here. Something like that is interesting. What may happen? I've already been invited to another realm by Jesus directly. He says, "Would you like to come visit my realm, my dwelling place, my house?" And I said, "Absolutely." He said, "All right, great." I said, "Let's do it." So I've already got that invitation. I'm aware of it, and I'm already part of the court of the Dharma King Longchenpa. Now I'm a very low, subordinate. I'm just maybe the lowest rung of subordinate. I don't know. But keep in mind that the lowest one who's been accepted into the court of the Dharma King is higher than any worldly authority whatsoever. Way higher, way higher. And I've always carried myself this way in the world because I feel my status is way higher than worldly authority, or at least it will be. I was aware of this. And so I've never felt like inferior to popes and presidents and all these big wigs. I said, they're quite inferior to me, way inferior. Because when you have real spiritual awareness and knowledge, this is way higher than anything worldly. Way, way, immeasurably. It's apples and oranges. So Jesus said that the lowest in the kingdom of heaven are higher than the highest in this kingdom of the flesh. And this is true. I understand this is absolutely true. So it's been suggested to me that I consider myself a Dharma prince, which is is the lowest subordinate in the court of a Dharma king. Above them you have the Bodhisattvas and the Dharma king. And a Dharma prince, I'm just starting out, but it means you have a certain status now that has been assigned, that you're a subordinate. You help out. You help out Longchenpa, which I'm trying to do, as this lowly subordinate. But still, as a lowly subordinate of a Dharma king, you are higher than any worldly authority, way higher. So it is these type of people that may come back to the world, is these Dharma princes, Bodhisattvas, and Dharma kings, to help reconstitute civilization here, if that's what's to take place. And I saw this world will host another civilization after this tribulation. It seems to be a technological civilization, though, what I saw. It's a terraforming. They terraform the world and make it very beautiful, like a big resort, like a big park. But they seem, it's hard to describe it exactly what's going to be like. We'll see. I actually saw it and wandered around the world and took a look at it, it was just, everything was lush and beautiful, and the plants were growing beautiful, and there were rivers everywhere, lakes and rivers everywhere. It didn't seem to be an ocean in particular. I wasn't sure about that, but I did know there's just tremendous amount of rivers and things navigated via rivers. People traveled via rivers, kind of like Bangladesh. There's so many rivers that people are used to traveling on rivers. It was very beautiful, this planet, very relaxed and very sort of slow-paced and beautiful. And people were suddenly shouted that Jesus was back, and everybody's running toward Jesus, say, "This Jesus is back." So it may be that there is this, reconstitution of civilization on this planet at some future point after the tribulation, and Jesus and the Dharma King Jesus and these various Dharma kings, Longchenpa, whoever comes back with their court, and again, I'm welcome in the court of Jesus too. Absolutely, I feel I'm also part of that. But there seems to be certain Dharma kings have the responsibility for those who fit best with them. And for me, it might be Longchenpa. It might be Jesus. I think it may be Longchenpa at this point. We'll see. It's not a big issue with me. They're all great. And we may come back and help civilization go along with that. And then the elite that come up underground, they may be the function, low functionaries that help organize it. There's some business acumen and organizational acumen, whatever. But the higher ups understand the purpose of civilization. So I've been very much schooled in what the purpose of civilization is all about. And, so I've really focused on this, of how to reconstitute civilization in the right way so it benefits us spiritually. This is what is key. I feel that there's a collapse in this world is coming, for sure. And it will have to be, civilization will be reconstituted. But we'll do it in a much better way. At least that's our plan. And it's very doable. It's absolutely doable. So I wouldn't worry about that. The Dharma kings know exactly what they're doing. And of course, we have free will. And so nothing can be forced upon us. And if we want to keep trying to buy our way out of reality, we'll just keep being observed. If we want to keep being observed, we can do that. But if the right emphasis on a genteel society, where people really discipline themselves and try to discipline their habits, away from all their bad habits. And great progress can be made if we all have the potential within us. It's within us. We just have to actualize it. We have to focus on it, make it number one priority. Making our awakening from this dream our number one priority is essential. That is what is essential. If someone asks me, what is essential? It's making our number one priority in life. There's nothing else can be co-priority number one. Okay, this is very important. Very, very important. Because this is what I've seen materialism tries to do, is tries to insinuate itself as saying, well, yeah, the spiritual path, that's a great priority. Okay, but we also are priority. So let's just make it co-priorities, to get this co-redeemerness nonsense. This is really materiality, absurdity, coming into the picture, the ego, claiming co-importance, co-authority, co-relevancy, co-priority. If you have a co-priority, you don't have a priority, actually. Jesus says you can't serve two masters. He's very adamant about that. So the number one priority, with nothing else even close, is our spiritual awakening to recognize timelessness, and that this dream that we're having, everything is actually always happening in the moment. The notion of time is just a dream, and it all happens in a moment. It's a feeling. It's a desire. It's a belief, and the belief in time is only contained within each moment. It never is moments joined together at all. We can imagine and believe in a trillion years, and we will, the moment of time when we're believing that, we will believe it will feel as if there's a trillion years there somehow, that this stretch, a trillion years stretches out before us. And the truth is, it's just actually a moment. That's all it is. So there's definitely an awakening. The grace of the guru can awaken us. So civilization can be reconstituted. It has been before, I believe, many times. And but so that's it in a nutshell. How are we doing on this? It's under an hour. Okay. There's a lot. I go really fast right now because we need to go fast. There's urgency to the situation. If you've noticed, there's a massive uptick in Rapture news and Planet X news in just ferment, you know. And I don't want people to get caught up in it because this will really cause you problems. Try to just kind of simplify it and put it into a spiritual context here. And I would say going forward, just keep working to try and make that this priority number one is your spiritual path, and take the gold standard. You realize, hey, there's nothing, no other priority, not family, not marriage, not education, none of that stuff is priority number one. Your relationships, spiritual study, discipline, determination is priority number one for everyone. This is the true civilization. And some civilizations in history have emphasized that, like India and Tibet. They emphasize, hey, your spiritual training is number one priority. Nothing else comes close. I mean, in India, a lot of, throughout history, marriage is just arranged. You don't even think about it. You keep working on your prayers and your rituals and your focus and all this stuff. And when it comes time to marry, that the guru will decide, what is the most suitable marriage partner. And it will be arranged, and marriage will happen, and then you continue on with your studies, and each one of you give yourselves, I mean, the marriage is there. They give each other like 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours a day for prayer and meditation and stuff. This is part of their life there. It's number one. Their marriage relationship is not number one. Never was. Never was designed to be. And you could still raise children, but you raise children correctly, showing them what are your true priorities. So in that case, the family becomes a wonderful family because it's showing what our priorities are here. You see, so it's not anti-family, anti-relationship at all. Relationships and family are only in the service of our number one priority, which is really our spiritual awakening. There's no question about this whatsoever. Don't ever doubt it for in the slightest bit. Refuse to doubt. This world tries to put all sorts of doubts in our mind. Our priest is a high school teacher also, teaches philosophy. He's a very bright guy, young guy, very bright. And he says most of the students are calls them existentialists or something like that. He says they're atheistic. They don't believe there's any purpose for life or anything. It's just, get what you can, indulge yourself the way however you want. There's no real purpose to life. I don't know why I'm here. I don't know. There's no answers. We just have to be here. I don't really want to be, but I've got to be. So let's just, he says almost all of them now, the young people, this is how they think. This is a high school teacher at a Catholic high school. Okay. I mean, you talk about someone giving a straight scoop about what's going on in this world right now. He says it's quite astonishing, actually, quite shocking. Okay, this is what happens when a world is really collapsing spiritually into materialism. And you get the yoga girl thing, as I call it, which is very powerful and strong in this world, which is essentially, materialism is what it is, the voice of materialism saying to spirituality. You got to understand the history of the last 50, 60 years. In the late 50s and then the 60s, there was a tremendous spiritual revival, especially among the youth. And they really said, we got to get answers. Well, why? Because they had an intuitive understanding that trouble was coming. You listen to some of the songs back then. Jimmy and All on the Watchtower, two riders are approaching, the wind begins to howl. He's talking about two rocks coming in, actually. There was a great intuitive awareness back then in the 60s and the 70s, there's big trouble coming to this, cosmological trouble coming to this planet. We have to get spiritually right. We got to get ourselves spiritually prepared. So a lot of young people began dropping out of society, out of the corporate ladder, out of education, everything, and taking a spiritual path, and both men and women. But what happened was the men felt like, hey, we want to continue this, whereas the women, their biological clocks were ticking, and they began to hear that tick-tock, tick-tock, tick-tock. Now, back then, it was still women had children early. You started having them early, and you didn't wait till your 30s, basically. I mean, nowadays, they wait till their 30s and 40s, but back then, no. So they're in their, these youth, they're starting their 20s and mid-20s, and they start saying, hey, I gotta get my family going here. I need a house, and I need money, and I need a stable husband. I need all the, so their minds began very much focusing on materiality and family, children, all this stuff. And they said, hey, wait a minute, all these guys are just into this, hippie hermit spiritual trip, and they're not into that stuff at all. They even have jobs and everything. And then they got really very upset about this. It was just this primal urge to, to have children and to have family and everything that overpowered them. And they became, v there's a huge backlash happened, and this became radical feminism, really. And they basically said, wow, we can't have all these, all our young men becoming hermits. And so they decided that they were going to put their foot down. It says, guys, this is what we're going to do. We're going to say, okay, this spiritual thingy, it's very cool, very hip, very nice. But also, this material thingy is also very cool and very nice. And guess what, guys? You can do it both. You can do it both. And we're going to show you how to do it both ways. And this is what I call it, this yoga girl phenomena has arisen in the world. This is the overriding paradigm in the world right now, is a yoga girl paradigm. And what they say is, hey, they're saying, hey, guys. And they're very condescending the way they talk now. It's amazing. Hey guys, this is the way it really is. Okay. Yeah, you can have your cup and your cake and eat it too. And you can have it all. This is part of their motto. You can have it all. Why are you trying to be hermit? You can have it all. You're super bad. You're great. I'm going to help you. We know spiritually, we know what's really important. And we will tell you, what your spiritual thingy is going to be about. And then you do your material thingy, and we'll take care of your spiritual path for you, and you do that, and you can do it both. The problem with this is the real purpose of all this is to turn the men away from genuine seeing of reality and truth, because when they see that, then they will be irresistibly drawn to like a hermit's type of life. They really will. They won't go into family life. So the yoga girl spirituality is superficial, very superficial, but they gloss it up a lot. They put lipstick on the pig. And they are so assertive about this. They've convinced the men that they know what spirituality is really about. And they applaud men and say, "Men, you're so wonderful. I'm so glad you got the spiritual side to you. And we want you to develop the spiritual side with you. And here's the books you need to read. Here's what you need to look at. This is how far you take it. This they set all these parameters and rules and laws. And you got Oprah there with her book clubs, pumping out the stuff that is, so this is how far you need to go. This so they set the entire parameters of the spiritual path for the men now. And so it's all designed to prevent the men from really going deep enough to actually glimpse and see what it's really about. Because if they do, they're going to realize, I can't do it all. There's no way. I've got to make this my number one priority, and nothing else is close, which means family, which means spouse, family, vacations, money, job, everything. That's secondary. That's secondary. And this is what happens when you get serious, when you really see what spirituality is all about. It's your number one priority for sure. So the yoga girls, they're saying, no. You can have co-priorities, spiritual path and materialism. Those are co-priorities. And they say, well, we're naturally talented at because we're very good at what do you call it? Multitasking. We're super talented multitasking. So we know how to do it, and we'll teach you how to do it too. But they're not doing it. The yoga girls are not doing it. They are really aiming at materialism and being pampered. I mean, what person on this planet doesn't want to be pampered? Very few. Almost everyone. If someone said, say, hey, I'm going to give you a new Mercedes, what are you going to say? They say, I'll pay for it, the insurance, everything is yours. Are you going to say no? Who's going to say no? I'm going to give you this beautiful home, beautiful clothes, food, vacations, money, security, education, whatever it is, music, culture, anything. If it's just going to be given to you, are you really, who's going to say no to that? Only some very dedicated hermits and those on the spiritual path who really know what it's about would say, no, I don't want that. I don't want that. Like for me, if someone said, I will give you all wealth and privilege and pampering in the world, and all you have to do is watch television, every day, all the time, it's a no-brainer. What do you think? I say it's no deal. There's nothing you can give me to get me to watch television. Nothing. Give me the whole universe, I wouldn't do it. Okay, so, but I'm not saying I wouldn't take some pampering, right? Yeah, so we're all vulnerable to that. And so you have to be very careful about that. And the nature of women is that they need to get get extra for their children. Okay, so that there's not a knock on women. It's just the way things work. This is how it works. You have to be pragmatic. A surplus. They want to have kids. They need to feel security and a surplus, and they need to see, you know, and plan ahead materially and stuff. So they need the structure and stuff. They want that. This is understandable. But you have to be very careful about not getting pulled into this idea of co-priorities. This will never work. You cannot serve two masters, and you cannot make them equal. And the yoga girls, what their whole thing is, let's make them equal. But what they're really saying is, no, let's make it materialistic. Because this, the spirituality they're presenting is very superficial. And it's designed to blind us to the real truth, the real non-dual truth, the real gold standard. They're saying, you know, that Oprah's the gold standard, or, you know, some these queen bees are. No, they're not. They're not even remotely the spiritual gold standard. They're very ignorant and superficial. They're very dualistic, okay? And yet, this whole thing, you know, the culture is amazing. The book clubs the women have, and the Queen Bee Oprah's giving, you know, telling them, this is the book you should read, this, you read this. And so they come across that. We're experts on spirituality. We know what books you're supposed to read. But it's they spin it in a very superficial way. And it's designed to make co-priority. Yeah, you're supposed to have your career, you're supposed to make a ton of money, nice house, new cars every 3-4 years, you know, the children go pay for their college education, all this stuff, and you're supposed to, you know, pursue your spiritual path so you feel fulfilled. This is not really possible. Okay, this is a pipe dream. The spiritual path is the most demanding thing there is in the world. Nothing even comes close. Nothing comes remotely close to the commitment you need. Okay, it is so difficult. The commitment is so essential. Every great gold standard Dharma king and queen in history has said this to us, that you have to commit and you have to give it everything you've got. It has to be your number one priority. You cannot serve two masters. So you, on one hand, you have the yoga girl philosophy running the world now, saying you can serve two masters and say, look at me, look how wonderful I am. I'm doing it, and look how wonderful I am. And you have all the gold standard great Dharma kings and queens in history saying you cannot do it that way. You will fail. And this is, you'll just find superficial delusion there and just have the form of spirituality without the substance. So that's what they say. So who do you think is telling the truth? I'll tell you, it's the Dharma kings and queens who set the gold standard, who are absolutely telling the truth. And the yoga girls are lying to us, plain and simple, because their heart is with materiality and with, they want to have children. I mean, I'd say if you want to take the spiritual path, don't have children. And throughout history, this has been the advice. Now, you can do it with children in certain cultures who understand you're not supposed to pamper the children, and your focus is on the spiritual path. That is, it's doable. It's doable. But you really have to be committed. So the householder is possible. Okay. But it's more advisable to not have children, actually. So there are some women who choose to not have children, to be nuns, that's consecrated life, like hermits or hermitesses, or however you say that, and renunciates. And they do get after it. They do get after it. They make it their number one commitment, and some of them do succeed. They absolutely do. So historically, this is how it goes. It is never more true than now. It has always been true. The spiritual path, because of our severely bad habits and familiarity with delusion, etc., and our lack of familiarity with truth, we have to make it our number one priority, and nothing else even comes close. So, you know, I'm so severe right now, like I'm boycotting everything. I'm boycotting the whole world, basically, including sports, all sports, which for me is like, you know, the ultimate commitment. That's the only thing that kept me, you know, keeps me going. Is there some narrative I can at least say, oh, okay, what's going on in the world that isn't terrible? Oh, okay, our sports team, maybe they'll win tonight. You know, maybe the Giants will win tonight. But the Holy Spirit told me, it's so severe right now, you got to even stop sports. I said, wow. I said, you got it, boss. You know, the ultimate boss, the Holy Spirit. And I said, okay, you got it. And I stopped cold turkey and haven't gone back to it, really. You know, it's just, you know, you flirt with a little bit. But I said, no. I'm boycott is a boycott. Boycott is a boycott. So, I mean, the Warriors are playing, and I'm not watching. I'm not even paying attention. I do a little chatter with the guys, you know, like, but I'm just faking it. I don't even know what's going on, really. I don't even check the scores. I don't know. Occasionally I will. It might come to my attention or something that this is what happened, or someone might ask me, and I say, oh, I don't want to act like I'm ignorant, but I'm boycotting sports along with a massive amount of other boycotts, the news, the newspaper, the news in general, all this stuff. Literally, my attention, I'm refusing to allow my attention to go there at all. So you might say I'm a de facto hermit, like in a cave seclusion almost. But still functioning in the world. But so it's possible to do this, but you have to be. I told someone today that I have to protect my faith 24/7, and he said, "That's I do too." If you don't do that, you're gonna fall right now. You have to protect your faith 24/7 right now. This is how bad it is in the world. The yoga girls are ferocious. They don't want to see the men of the world. They don't want to see a spiritual revival where the men decide they're going to be hermits, because you know what? Their standard of living is going to fall. And this is why they're so insistent on getting into all these nice jobs with a lot of money, because they're afraid that men may very well do that. And so they say, well, I want to have a lot of money for my kids so I can live in nice pamper lifestyle. A lot of these radical feminists, guess where they are now? Very pampered lifestyles is where they're at right now. And they used to be hippie chicks, okay? They really did. They were on the spiritual path. Oh, this is cool. And suddenly the biological, uh-oh. And they ended up, millionaires with millionaire husbands, wealthy, powerful, elite type of men. Absolutely. Because a lot of these radical feminists were intellectuals, very, very, very high, trust fund intellectuals. So when they decided to go back to the world, they could hook up with wealthy men. And they did. They did. So they want to be pampered. So they don't want men bailing out on the family. They don't. And there was a big, there was a huge, back in the 60s, you just cannot imagine how it was really if you weren't there. A lot of men, I don't know what the percentage was, you could throw, say, half if you want, or even more than half, were saying, I'm not going to go into corporate culture at all. I'm just going to be a hippie. I'm not going to do it. But I never did it, really. I never did it. I've never been in corporate culture at all. We said no to it. We said no. I'm going to take a spiritual life instead. And so you get the women looking at that, and they say, "Wow, I may be left out in the cold. My whole standard of living is going to fall." When the bottom line is reached with them, what happened was most of them decided go back to materiality, and this is where the severe backlash happened. Some decided not to go back to materiality very much, and they became hippie women, but they still had children and they just raised them as hippies and stuff. But they were still dedicated to that instead of the spiritual path. You have to be dedicated to the spiritual path. I give it, how much time do I give it every day? I don't know, maybe eight, all day actually, really, 24/7, I'm after it. 24/7. And the other stuff, it's peripheral, very peripheral. And if your family can put up with that, that's great. That's great. Not everyone can put up with that by any means. And I don't have any money, nothing to pamper, no income to do any for any sort of pampering at all. It just barely pay, bills, if that, and with help. So, it's just bare bones type of thing. And not many women are going to go for that. I don't care what their lips say. Deep down, they're going to want some excess. They're going to want some pampering. They're going to want some nice stuff. They want their kids to have a great life. Okay, what woman doesn't want their kids to have a great? What mother doesn't want their kids to have a great life? Of course they do. So, they want their kids. So they want to be successful. And if you don't have anything to get them in the good schools, do anything, no vacation, they say you're ruining our kids. And they just can't handle that. For me, it's like no vacations. I mean, I'd have the kids meditating, and they'd say, no, I want my kids to, travel and see the world and do this and this and that. I said, I got no money for it at all. That would just, they'd just be too upset about that. So it doesn't work very well. In India and various places, it has worked because the expectations are a lot lower. The kids are going to, they seem to be very lax about that. They say, well, the kid's going to be a priest or he's going to be a sadhu. And then they'd say, the mother would weep and cry, but the father would say, well, this is okay. And that's what would happen. And Ram Maharshi just left his family at what, 15? Disappeared, basically. His mother finally tracked him down and begged and cried and just gave the biggest hysterical scene imaginable to for him to come back to the family. And he just was completely silent and mute and didn't even move a muscle or bat an eye. Eddie says, what will happen will happen. What will not happen will not happen. There's absolutely nothing we can do about it. And ultimately, you know, she actually came to join him and live there in a hut and became a you know, great disciple, actually. That's pretty unusual. So there's always this desire. You know, mothers want their children to be worldly successful. You know, very few. When you hear in history, like the son who's going on to become a great sage will say to the mother, "I'm leaving," and they very few say, "Okay, that's great." They almost always look at Buddha's mother, did everything possible to prevent him from leaving. This is how it works. They don't want you to go into spiritual life. They don't want you to. It tears them up inside. And so that's no different now than it was in the past. And you had this hippie generation of dropouts of people listening to all these great gurus and teachers. And they're saying, wow, I think this is what I really want to do. I really feel this. And they did feel it. And they didn't want to go back to the corporate world. And this really freaked the women out. It really freaked them out at some point. They went along with it for a while because it was fun and amusing and adventurous, and they wanted to see the world too. But then when that biological clock started getting real loud, they said, hey, time to get down to business here, guys. And we need you, you know, we need you to start working here. And that's when radical feminine started really clamping down on men, severely clamping down in every which way possible to intimidate them. It's very much an intimidating situation, radical feminism. Yoga girl culture is very much into trying to infantize men and telling men, look how benevolent we are. We're giving you spirituality. You know, this is what you can do. I mean, we're not standing in your way at all. But they are standing in the way, because it's like a mother standing in the way of a child. Say, no, I'm very indulgent. What do you mean? Go ahead and read this book. But, you know, I think you've spent enough time reading it now. Now get back to work. And you say, no, I want to study this book for the next 15 years, which is what I did with A Course in Miracles. I spent 15 years of my life doing basically heavily just studying that. 14, 16 hours a day, 18 sometimes, just sometimes around the clock. 15 years. You know, they're not going to let you do that. You're not going to go to work. I didn't have any work, nothing. They're going to say, oh, you could study it like 10 minutes a day, maybe half an hour, but no, that's excessive. You know, you don't want to be excessive. That's not fair. You know, let's balance. Have a balanced, harmonious life. Come on. Happy wife, happy life. This is ridiculous. Okay. That is never going to work, which means you're going to be kept in severe delusion. Severe delusion. So the worst thing in the world is the yoga girls. They're the worst. They're the worst. Because they seem to be offering us this deal of let's multitask and have it both ways, and we should be able to do it, when in fact the matter is you can't do it that way. You cannot do it that way. And they're very, very strident and insisted upon this. And mother knows best, you know, that the superficial spirituality, and they get these people, figureheads, who say, no, you should get it like easy. You don't have to spend much time. Yeah, 10 minutes, you know, 10 minutes a day should be enough. Come on. This is a joke. This is a joke. Doesn't work that way at all. Our delusion is very severe. Our continuity fear is very severe. Our attempt to buy our way out of reality is very intense. Our familiarity, our expectations, the whole ball of wax is very, very intense. And it gives us a sense of entrapment and fear. And we have to really be dedicated to cutting through the knot of absurdity and being very humble and being willing to get in, being a subordinate of a Dharma king or queen, getting into that the grace of their court, and now in terms of working our way up, you know, it ultimately we're all the same, we're all perfect, we're all absolutely free, we're all that way right now. The truth of the matter is that those who are suffering are actually trying to be greater than God. Okay, they're trying to be greater than themselves, really. And so it's not so like if there's someone like a Dharma prince, for instance, which I say that I'm working towards accepting that role. It was offered to me, and so I may seem to be way more spiritual aware more. And people say, "Oh, well, you're superior to me," and I say, "No, I'm not. Actually, I'm equal to you in spirit, but you're trying to be greater than me. Your affliction, your unawareness, all this kind of stuff. Those are symptoms of arrogance, of trying to be greater than what you really are." So I'm. The only difference is a Dharma prince is they're less arrogant. They've been able to drop some of their arrogance, not all of it, but a lot of it, you might say. And they're becoming more spiritually aware of their natural condition. Whereas the others, who are suffering and having all these troubles, they're suffering because of their arrogance, and they haven't yet dropped their arrogance. They're still holding on to it, and so the trouble is not that I'm like superior. It's that others are trying to be superior to me. I see the spiritual equality ultimately in all of us. It's actually here right now. We're all equal right now. We just don't realize it. So it's those who seem lower. They only seem lower because they're trying to change what they are. That's a fact. That's a fact. So there, I don't accept this guilt trip. Oh, you're trying to be superior. No, it's just exactly the opposite. Those who seem lower are actually trying to be superior and suffering from such an attempt. But temporarily, it does seem that there are those who seem to have higher awareness, greater spiritual awareness, because they've dropped their arrogance, and the Dharma kings have no arrogance. They've dropped it all. And they've become familiar with this. I've met them, and there's no arrogance in them. You feel like, just feeling like they're so peaceful and calm, and they look at you with this feeling of like you're just completely equal, all is one. There's no arrogance in them at all. It's amazing. You just like, wow. This is like the one most wonderful, I've never met anyone like this. It's extraordinary. They're so gracious and kind. They treat you like a jewel. They're not on some spiritual ego trip at all. And they're just very calm. It's hard to describe. You have to experience it. But at the same hand, they're vastly more aware spiritually than you are, because you still have some arrogance and bad habits. You have to, work through this. So you bow to them and understand you're a subordinate. That if you can help them out, that's a great blessing. But so sorry, you have to keep this dichotomy that temporarily you're less spiritually aware, but ultimately you're exactly the same. We're all perfect. And we just have this temporary denial of this fact that we have to grant, we have to let go of this and get familiar with our, all this equal perfection and perfect freedom of reality. God gave all to all, and there's no special preference anywhere whatsoever in creation, and there never will be. So I'm just going over these spiritual parameters. I'm going to boost the light here because the light is going down outside. I do this taping outside for those of you who don't know. It's way better to, I love doing this outside. And the birds give me a nice background soundtrack to all of this. So we started out with, Planet X. I said I put in a spiritual context, which we're doing here. And I'm pointing out that, there's a big spiritual trouble in the world where you're trying to have it all. You can't have it all. You can't be this superhero to the family and to society as far as this big, business person, successful this, successful that, and at the same time, be a Dharma prince. This is an idealized image that people have, but I can tell you that it doesn't really work that way. It doesn't work that way, and so don't count on that, happening for you. You have to put your spiritual path first. There is absolutely no way around that. So don't even try to get around it. Now, you will find that this causes problems in terms of your special relationships and family and stuff like that. Yeah, absolutely, it can be difficult. It depends on who your relationships are and family and all that kind of stuff. I kind of do it just kind of off the radar, so to speak. I don't really make any announcements to anyone I know closely of what my focus is at all. They don't even know. They don't even know. I'm just a lowly, in their eyes, I'm just kind of this lowly, do-nothing person, that just tries to be cheerful, and that's pretty much it. You can't say, well, I'm a Dharma prince. They say, what are you talking about? You're just this lowly person. Well, I've been committed to the spiritual path as my number one priority my entire life, very intensely. That gets you somewhere, right? I mean, it wears away some of the arrogance that you can be greater than God. Wears that away. And then you seem to be rising up, in spiritual awareness. People, oh, you're so much superior. No. I'm just going back to my natural state. It's the other ones who are trying to rise above the natural state that seem so fallen, that seem so confused with complexity. When you're trying to buy your way out of reality, you're going to get hooked into complexity for sure. For sure. And this is why we have this very complex society now, that everyone's trying to buy their way out of reality. They think that that maybe they can get the price of purchase, get the means of purchasing it, get the means of purchasing a freedom from freedom is what we're really trying for. But they think, well, it must be very complex. I can't figure it out. It's just it's, this isn't quite it. This isn't, and so they hide into go more and more into complexity because if they're going towards simplicity, they would see, oh, this is just all ridiculous. It's so easy to see. So they avoid simplicity like the plague. As if it were the plague. So if you ever give anyone the intimation that you're very simple-minded, this scares the heck out of them. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said, I said, told everyone, I'm just this very simple-minded little child. That's all I am. Let's just see me like that. But people said, no, we want to see you as our mother, meaning we want to see you someone who's a master of complexity. And she said, no. She said, no. Don't, whatever you do, she said, don't see me as a mother. That's why I call her Sri Sri Anandamayi, not Anandamayi Ma tendency. I put that in there just for familiarity's sake. But said, don't see me as the mother. This is a big mistake because that implies distance, but it ultimately implies complexity and mastery of complexity, so to speak. Whereas she said, the truth is very, very simple. All Dharma kings and queens say this. It is very simple. It is very evident. It is black and white, cut and dried. It's our inability to see that. That's the trouble. It's right there in front of our noses. All the time. But our commitment to complexity is so severe, we literally cannot put our attention on it. And occasionally we get a glimpse of it and say, oh my gosh, that's it. And then 2 minutes later, 2 seconds later, we're back into complexity and it's vanished. We say, what happened to it? Right? What happened? Well, we're back into complexity because it's that nasty habit we have. Very nasty habit. The truth is very simple. We cannot purchase our freedom from freedom. We are inescapably it. Meaning, absolutely free. We are inescapably absolutely free. And we can never purchase our freedom from freedom. It's impossible. End of story. It's that simple. End of story. It's that simple. And this is the way to reconstitute civilization is to stress non-dual simplicity, is to stress simplicity. Truth is not complicated. It's very simple. Therein lies the trouble for everyone. Especially in this very complex technological age, it's getting more and more complex, which is why I reject it. I boycott the world. I'm boycotting this world. I'm not even going to stay in this world, very likely. So I'm not really interested in what's happening in this world. I don't. It's not important. It's really not important to me, in general. I understand pragmatically, but in terms of like, oh, they need to go somewhere. Need to is this where, not, is this world really important? No, not really. I know there's better worlds than this. Way better worlds, actually. If you want a world at all. So it's not a priority at any, the world's not a priority to me anymore. So we are inescapably it. Inescapably, it's very simple, and this complex society culture is getting way more complex. I just said, no, I'm not going there. I'm not going there. Don't have a smartphone, forget it. Technology has been a massive headache for me. Just terrible. It's like raping my mind, really. It's just off my spirit. Just awful, awful stuff. Is this commitment to complexity, which is arrogance. Truth is absolutely simple. In fact, it's self-evident, completely inherent. It's like our spaciousness is inherent. Everything is just abiding in its own inherent spaciousness. It's completely simple, absolutely simple. You don't even need any thought for it at all. Take any thought, you lose the absolute simplicity of it. Any thought at all, you lose it. That's why abidance is just in no thought. Is you don't need any thought. It's not that thoughts has to stop. You just give them no importance whatsoever. Like passing clouds, you don't need to even pay attention to them. They have nothing to do with the absolute simplicity of being. which is perfectly evident, self-evident, intrinsic spaciousness. And yet we're trying to figure out, you know, like we can't see it. It's like, oh, it must be super complex, the answer. And we're, you know, seeking. God, these computers crunching numbers for us and everything. Maybe they'll help us find it, you know. It's ridiculous. It is so ridiculous. We don't understand how ridiculous it is. We're going in the wrong direction. Complexity is entirely the wrong direction. I didn't say we're going to foolishness or stupidity. No, I'm just saying utter simplicity. That is not foolishness at all. Complete, utter simplicity. That's why I say prior to priorness, really. And prior to that, and prior to that. I mean, just it's fundamentally prior to what? Any thought of priorness. Our being is so simple, completely self-evident, it is prior to any priorness, any thought, concept, consideration, notion whatsoever of anything at all, any priorness, even the thought of priorness, it's prior to that. So the thought of priorness, it's prior to that. So don't worry about reconstituting civilization in the right way. The Dharma kings are well aware of how to do that. Their subordinates will help them out, do what they can, and you will get it, all right, eventually. So don't be overly concerned. Realize that it is possible that the rapture will occur, okay? Don't think that's the provenance of simply Christians at all. Jesus never said such a thing. The idea of God has his people and nobody else is God's people is ridiculous. God plays no favorites at all. It's whoever has prepared is what's important. Whoever has prepared, who buys into simplicity, true, absolute simplicity, says this is my goal. This is what I really want. This is what the truth is. The truth is. It's not a thought of isness. It's the isness itself. It's prior to any conception or thought of business. Just abide as that. As that. Those who want that, they will be saved. I mean, they absolutely will. You'll get an invitation somehow. You'll get a ticket. You'll be on board. Okay, so focus on that. Focus on that. If you want complexity, you'll stay with the world. Very complex place. Becoming more so all the time, isn't it? More bells and whistles every day, exponentially. But, you know, I said Catholic Mass, you know, yesterday, and, you know, reading the Magnificat, this book they had there, and all, you know, just paying a lot of attention and just get the vibe of it, and, you know, it's all about God, rescue your people, pay attention to your people, save your people. We are your people. We are your chosen people. They're constantly emphasizing specialness with God, which is the wrong emphasis. You know, there's so much great rhetoric in the Christianity, but there's also so much wrong emphasis, actually. They're trying to have their cake and eat it too. Again, that problem. There's no such thing as God's. We're all God's people. There's no favoritism, no specialism in God whatsoever. Zero. And there never will be. This comes from Jesus, actually. And the idea that you know, that where God shows, it is so wrong, so mistaken. The emphasis, I say, and then so much petitioning of, you know, God smite my enemies, help get rid of my enemies, and the bad people, get rid of them, defeat them, and help me with my afflictions, all this stuff. That is such wrong emphasis. It really is. So the form is really nice, but the emphasis is very mistaken. And there's just no question about it. I mean, I've immersed myself in it for so long. I'm just trying to say, what is going on here? It's very confusing. And they're keeping the ego's emphasis and trying to use this form of the Holy Spirit, trying to use that as the form of it all. And they think that this will purchase their freedom from freedom. They think they found a very clever juxtaposition. No, it won't purchase your freedom from freedom. Nothing ever will. So you got to give up. You got to get right emphasis about this. Everyone's perfect. God created perfection. There's only perfection. No one has fallen. There's never been a fallen. No moment has ever been tied to another moment. Reality is still functioning perfectly. There's never been any fall. It's just a dream. And every dream's just in the moment. So you're still absolutely free. Everyone's still absolutely free. Nothing can happen in our experience that we don't just decide to choose to dream that's happening, imagine is happening. No, there's no such thing as disadvantage. We're only dreaming that to try to attain the purchase price of freedom from freedom. The money, you know, the means. We think, oh, look, this is a disadvantage, this suffering, this death will provide me the means that I can be free of freedom. We bring it upon ourselves, 100%. So who's our enemy, really? It's our own selves. It's our own desire to be separate from God. That's the enemy. And that's not separate from us. That's our own desire. That's our arrogance. We need to set that down and say, God, I'm through with that trip. And God will just laugh and say, that was a real doozy, huh? We say, yeah. And how did we get free? Well, the grace of the guru set me free. I don't know. It's the grace of the guru did it. That's how I was set free. Right? Don't be pinned in explanation, because that's not it. Then you're not abiding. If you're trying to look at priorness, you're not in priorness. You're in a dream. You're not looking at. How can you look at priorness? You are priorness. You are inherent spacious. Who's looking at inherent spaciousness? I am spaciousness. So it's the grace of the guru that awoke me to this, that I've always been free, and there's no attainment at all, actually. How could there be an attainment? There's two moments are not joined together at all. Every moment's absolutely free and clear of every other moment. So the grace of the guru is what did it. So I don't know how I got free. It's the grace of the guru. Somehow you have to ask them how they did it. Go ask them, right? Now this is for another video. We can get into that. It's something new that's developing. That I'm just realizing, hey, the grace of the guru can awaken us. Okay, so we will not delve into that. I can feel that I still need to get more familiar with that. You can get this feeling like I can't quite talk at this. It'll be kind of a strain. So we're not scared of the future here. I'm not like prepping and doing all this stuff. I'm prepping to go to another place, another realm, actually. I'm part of, I will be part of reconstituting civilization on a spiritual basis at some point. This is what I've specialized in. I've really studied religion and institute all this stuff my whole life. I've saying, how can we do better? What are the mistakes that Christianity made? What are the mistakes that some religions have made? How can we give right emphasis here and make sure we don't get back in trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit? And ultimately, our goal is to purchase freedom from freedom. This is what we're really trying to do. Thinking that this is our salvation. We can't do that. It's impossible. It's not complex. It's impossible. So this is a very simple differentiation, right? It's cut and dried. There's zero complexity to this. It's not complex. It's impossible. What is impossible can never be complex. You see, those are two mutually exclusive categories. If something's impossible, there's zero complexity to it. How can there be complexity to what is impossible, what can never happen? There can't be. There cannot be. So if you can see that, then you're going to be saved, because this is the utter simplicity that if you can see that and accept it. So I see it. Yeah, it's obvious to me. This is what I mean by simple-minded. What is impossible can never be complex. So this whole complexity of mind of trying to purchase our freedom from freedom is ridiculous. It's nothing but absurdity. It's a zero. It goes nowhere. We never fuse two moments together, no matter what our dreams are. It's always in the moment. Whatever we do is in the moment. We have never fused two moments together, ever. We never will. That's our absolute freedom. are we doing here? 140. Okay, very nice. Getting a good video here. Yeah. Okay. I could go on. Maybe I want to retain some energy going forward here. So, I hope that this video has helped with your ambience, your overall feeling is what's important. Your overall feeling is what's important. And don't intellectualize it. It's prior to priorness. What we are is formless spirit. We're prior to the form of priorness. Okay? Whatever form of priorness we want to imagine, we're prior to that. We could even say, I'm prior to thatness. Thatness being some sort of indication. I'm prior to any indication of what I am. Of priorness. Completely prior to any indication. And no indication is any more or less prior than any other indication. I'm fundamentally prior. Essentially, inherently prior. And this is what we have to keep hammering at. Keep hammering at. This is what the Dharma Kings and Queens advise us. They keep hammering away at this. And gradually, you know, it sinks in. Wow, this is what they're getting at. And ultimately, it turns out to be abidance. And you're enlightened. Enlightenment is abidance. It's just as I am, you know. Abidance, just as I am. And is, you know, that's what it is. And ultimately, we will be this abidance. We certainly will. Nice little bird there, chipping in. It's 2 cents worth. No mistake about it. We will be that. That prior to any thatness, or prior to any suchness, or anything we can imagine this. Prior to priorness. And there's no thought we can take that can expound upon it or clarify it at all, actually. That's why I say we're just you know, we're abiding in the grace of the Guru, which is thoughtless. This thought, this freedom from all thought, which we can say is like a grace. You know, we can't explain it at all, can we? We cannot expound upon it at all. We cannot expound upon our being at all, actually. Not at all. It's ineffable. Entirely so. So all homage to those beatniks and those hippies and those dropouts and those Dharma bums and, you know, all those who knew the right thing to do and who got after it and may still be getting after it, actually, under the table of the civilization, right, of the demands. And, you know, sneaking around the yoga girls and not letting them get their claws on them and clutches and, you know, telling them the way that they're supposed to do it. Homage to all those who have continued on. Through thick and thin, it's been very difficult, to say the least, but it's been a worthwhile challenge, hasn't it? Or you still have that connection, right? You still have that intuitive connection. Hasn't been easy. A lot of intimidation has been thrown our way. A lot of pressure. We feel like outcasts. For sure. But someday, we'll be welcome somewhere and saying, wow, we were waiting for you. We're so glad you're here. Make yourself at home. Stay as long as you want. We're thrilled that you're here. And then you can hit your stride. You start focusing more and more on simplicity, and you hit your stride. You absolutely can. You absolutely can hit your stride. I'm working on it, you know, hitting my stride more and more. So together, we're walking together in the wow, hitting our stride just at the right time historically. All right? So keep the faith and just keep on striding. As they used to say in the 60s, keep on trucking. very great. Full stop on the wow, no wow. That's it for this one.